All right, so I'm gonna do a quick video. In case you're wondering what this weird table is, it basically sits on top of the body mount or the box mounts. It's just something to stand on so I can get up and paint the roof. There's definitely better ways to do that. But anyway, video's not about that. I just finished clear coating this truck about an hour ago, maybe longer. And it's pretty shiny. It's okay. I tried something that I'd never tried before. And I had basically a dry spot or a blur on the edge of the door and the fender. But because of how I shot the truck, I was able to add a little bit without creating a real bad dry spot. So a blur or a dry spot is basically a hazy spot where if it's wet and it starts to cure and you get a little bit on, it tends to, you know, you get a little blur. It looks like a dull spot. The reflection isn't good. But even though I did the fender and basically I was coming from the front back this way, I finished up the cabin up, and there was a blur up in here and a little bit on the fender. I tried to hit that, and normally what happens is you can only paint it at a certain speed, so it's already starting to dry here when you're painting back here. So in this case, I was moving so fast, I wanted to try this. Now this is a work truck, so I'm not too worried about this truck. I mean, it's I want it to be nice, but it doesn't have to be like a, you know, like a road runner or anything like that. So right here there was a bad blur, and right here basically not quite enough clear coat. Now if you come back and add some clear coat, I mean, that's okay because you can buff it out later. But look, as you can see, I mean, it's there might be a bit of a hazy spot. Wow. Yeah, I'm gonna call it good. Realistically, I could spend maybe 5 minutes with a buffer, but I mean, it's pretty nice. So basically how I pulled this off, today there was a video earlier today on Paint Society's channel. Brian at Paint Society showed where he basically takes the paint gun, and when he does the clear coat, he narrows the fan down a touch until the gauge bumps. So I'm gonna show you that in a minute. But what it allowed me to do is paint really, really fast. Now, if you're a little nervous and you're already painting okay, maybe don't try it. When I saw the video, I thought it was interesting and I wanted to try it. I paint a lot of complete vehicles. I don't do a lot of collision work. Like in this case, I did the cab, and I'll do the box and tailgate separate and bolted on. Just because I had to buy a different box for this truck anyway. There's a little bit of orange peel. You can probably see it a little bit on the hood. It's about as good as if you went to buy a Kia or a Hyundai. The rest of the truck is like a mirror, which is nice. So I think what I'm going to have to do in my booth, either on that wall or on the ceiling, I'm going to put a little bit of a better light, because there's a spot where I can't quite catch the light, and that's what happens. This side, this is what you got. This is not cut and buffed or anything. This is, I don't even want to touch it because it's wet. And it looks like it's flat. This clear is nice because it flattens out. And it's not a good clear, it's a cheapy clear. Well, I'm told it's a middle of the road clear, but it's the cheapest stuff I use if I'm doing like a work type truck or something. This truck I would have normally done in a single stage. I mean, look at the reflection even off the back wall. And I mean, that's probably the worst part of the truck is that back wall. And the reason why I say that is because I start with above. When I do a cab, what I like to do is you need like a couple step stools or whatever you want to do, but I basically do across the hood up top as glassy as I can. Then I jump up on the back and I basically paint from the wet back. And then while you're back here, you've got this little divider in most trucks of some sort, so I'll shoot that in there. There was a run from the factory here, and I guess I didn't sand it out enough. So that's just my paint's over a run. It's not a run that we got. If anything, it's, wow, look at that. That's pretty cool. Anyway, so basically, Yeah, this worked out pretty good. But yeah, basically, we wanted the same color, the factory color, because if anything happens, he wants to be able to take it anywhere and you know, get it touched up or whatever. So it's all to the factory code and all that kind of thing. So that's why I did a base clear. Now I did Limco Supreme, which is kind of it's a okay base coat. Anyway, let me show you the clear coat I used. I don't know if it matters. You can get this here in Canada. I don't know if you can get it everywhere else. There you go, Pure Reflections, PR201. It comes with the hardener. It's a 4-to-1. It's really liquidy like water, but it shoots on sticky and it stays there. So basically, with this trick, what Brian explained was that, well, here, let me show you how to adjust the gun. Let's start with that. I'm going to set my camera on a box here in a strange way. The gun, I don't know if it matters. It's a 4500 Protec. It's okay. It's a Canada. It's about a $250, $260 gun. It might be more than that now. I've had it a couple years. Great base gun. Not bad with the clear coat. But let me show you what Brian did. Oh, hang on, I gotta turn on my hair. So basically, okay, so let's say you have wide open fan. All right, and then you back the fan off just a little bit Did you see that? The gauge bumps up. Okay, now when I do that, my fan goes from like, now the fan on this particular gun, and this is why I like it for base. You know, there's this trick here, right? Where you do this and you do this, and that should be what hits the truck. I'd need a much bigger hand. The fan on this thing is insane. And it does fill the whole thing in between. It's almost like you're shooting a, I don't know, like a cucumber instead of a straight banana. I don't know how to explain that, but it's really, really wide. So when I turned down the fan and the gauge bumps up, it narrows the fan a little closer to what you want. Maybe a little bit narrow, but not crazy. It adds just a touch more pressure. The thing he explained was you know, like, you can't mess around and be slow. You do have to go fairly fast. I tend to be a bit of a slow shooter, so I tried this because I'd prefer to go quicker. But I find if I go too quick, even if I do, like, you do your 50-50 overlap, you know, every time you do a coat, I find it's slow. So what happens is, now, if you're painting a vehicle in pieces, like when I do a hot rod or a muscle car, I do the doors, fenders, and stuff, I do the body, it's all separate, and I keep track of my pressures. That's what I know how to do, that's what I've always done. So this base clears a bit, you know, different, I guess. I do some. But I mean, it's not what I do. I've never done the collision shop thing, so I don't have lots and lots of experience like a collision guy would have. Anyways, so the nice thing with this, it goes on about so wide, so not like crazy, but about here, more or less. And I was doing the 50-50, and basically this speed. And I mean, you know, it's easier with the gun, but you get the idea. So you have to be fairly quick so that you don't run it. Now, that could depend on the clear you're using. I think what Brian at Paint Society was using is probably a little bit thicker. Or maybe it throws a little more fluid than my gun. Yeah, I mean, again, you can set that up, right? But the way I had my gun set up, and I set it up exactly, and what I do is I go all the way to wide open, and I adjust it until it hits the trigger, and then I do one turn in. And I mean, that's a lot of fluid. Some guns you can do like a quarter turn in, half a turn in, whatever, whatever. Mine, you could probably do a little more. But I'd like to go a little bit slower, but in this case, I set it up the way I was used to it. and I basically did that little bump trick. And I gotta say, what was really cool, so I did the roof, I went down one side, and I came across up the fender over the hood, and I basically chased the wet the whole time down this side. And when I came up to that corner, so the first thing I did was the roof, which I started in the far corner and I finished right in this corner. And then I went down that side, and of course I shoot the back because if there's a bit of a blur here, I don't really care. Then I did the other side all the way around and I came back this side. So the almost the first thing I did is right here on the roof. The last thing I did was literally right here. Look, there ain't no blur. Like, nothing bad happened there. That is, for most vehicles. Now, if you were in a big shop with a super crazy paint booth and all the good stuff, this thing would look like $1 million. So, you know, thanks, Brian, for showing that trick. It's a trick where if you would have shown that to me a couple years ago, I probably couldn't have done it. But I had no problem doing it today. And I'm really happy with this truck. And the nice thing with this clear, I find it goes on a little bit like Kia. And what I mean by Kia is like when you buy a new Kia, there's a little bit of orange peel in them. If I catch just below the window edge here, you can kind of see a little bit of orange peel there. By tomorrow morning, a lot of that will be gone. I find the hoods tend not to go... Well, I mean, look, that's... There's a bit of orange peel in the hood at the far end, but I mean, I could probably buff that out because I do about a 70% overlap on the hood because it's flat, so you can go a little thicker. And when you come to the edge, you know, just keep in mind you don't want to run this, so you don't put too much, but put enough. But the nice thing is... The way it goes on fast, in this particular case, I found if you come across and come down and you see a spot you missed, as long as you commit and go in heavy, like it'll set right in there. So it kind of just goes on faster and stays wetter while you're doing it, so to speak. It doesn't stay wetter longer, just that you're moving so fast that you have more time to do that. And the cool thing, like I say, from beginning to end, way up in that corner, no blur. The little bit of a blur that I had, I thought, well, do I do a third coat on the whole thing? And I thought, I'm going to hit it and see what happens. And if I get a dry spot, who cares? Because I'll do it, you know, then I'll do a third coat if I have to, you know, 20, 30 minutes later. But I'm really happy with this. It was wet enough that it sucked it right in. I mean, I'm not even going to touch that, to be honest. I think that's great. So it all depends on what you want to do. Now, I mean, there's enough clear coat on this. I basically did a, how did I do it? I did a sticky coat. This stuff is weird. It doesn't always like that. So I wouldn't say a fog coat, but I kind of just get the clear on the truck. Again, that's something Brian kept saying over and over for the last few years. And... I've always been more of a commit to like a, say, medium coat and then do like a medium wet, like, or well, I guess a full wet coat, a medium wet coat, a full wet coat, and then possibly another one. But now my first coat, I just go around and I kind of stick it all over the car, let it set, atomize the crap out of it and basically turn it into glue. But you don't want to do fog. You want to make sure it sticks. And again, different clears do different things. What I can do with that clear I showed you, say the PPG Omni can't do that. I find that stuff you got to do like a medium coat, so make sure it's heavy enough but not so heavy that it runs. And then the next coat you can do a wet coat, and then it always takes a third coat. The PPG Omni is what it is. I think it's like a cheaper collision clear. Now in Canada it costs quite a bit of money, so you know, there's other kits. Try different things. Different guns, different people shoot differently, so different clears work. This stuff is fairly inexpensive. This is what I call the work truck special, so I price this differently than if I'm doing a hot rod or a muscle car. If somebody wants something like this, like I'm not going to give out prices over the internet, but basically, yeah, this is going to be a really good looking truck. We even found, I was at a junkyard, and I found a real nice clear headlight. And another guy had these two lights down here, which were better than what was on the truck. They're not perfect. And then, but he had this headlight with those. So these two headlights are about the same, where every other one that I've seen are so faded or fogged or yellowed. So, I mean, and I found a grill that was a little better than what he had. So that'll be good. But, I mean, he can always put a brand new, you know, go to LMC Truck and order a new grill. And the thing is, a lot of the GMCs and the Chevys, I think after 02, were different. So the grill in these is, it's a little bit of an oddball to find, but the front bumper is different. And so is the front fenders on this than a GMC. So I couldn't get, you know, with the supply chain and everything going on, I couldn't get front fenders for this truck. So I basically remade metal from here down. So I made those. And I think I show that in another video somewhere. And this side wasn't too bad, but on the other side, I basically had to remake a whole fender arch. And I just cut it out and did it the same way you'd do a back one, except I made the panel. So check it out. I had to make the body line and everything. Now you can't tell by looking at it because I got it pretty straight, but that body line should be a touch higher. But when you look at that, it looks pretty factory to me, right? So there's that one. Yeah, you can see how it's a little bit different, but more or less the same. So you know what? It's probably more the same than I thought it was. But anyway, so basically, there's a whole patch panel put in here, and if you want to watch a guy who does really good work doing, you know, homemade patch panels and whatnot, and I basically did it exactly the way he did it, check out Lakeside Auto Body, and, you know, give him a subscribe. He's really good. He shows a lot of old school ways of doing stuff. It's quick and it works. You know, and you don't have to be afraid to take a piece of metal and make things fit. Like a lot of guys I find get really, really picky and do super nice work, and that's great, and I'm not knocking anybody. I think that's amazing. But sometimes, you know, depending on the vehicle and whatnot, it's just a matter of getting it done. And check out, like I say, Lakeside Auto Body. He'll show you how to make panels and put them on, knock them into place, a little bit of fill, and everything he shows you, how to do the lines, how to do everything, is literally everything I did to make this. This fender has basically been replaced from here up into this body line. So basically up to here. Yeah, so I had to make that line in my piece, right? And there's ways of doing that. So go check out those videos. Next time I gotta make one, I'll do a video and I'll make some panels. And now I did that, and also this side, that whole bottom is new. So what happens is back in here, way up high, there's this weird pocket in the back. Basically fills with sand and mud. These rot from the inside out. So this edge seems to last forever. So keep that edge, make your panel from here to here, make your bend. And I mean, you can put wheel flares, anything. I basically matched it to what was on the truck before. I should have left a light on here, but anyway, you get the idea. So, hey, Brian, thanks, man. There's a lot of tricks, but look at that. You can see all the roof stuff in the hood. I mean, yeah, I'm pretty impressed. Yeah, I'm a little speechless. I'm trying to find that little blurry spot. It's going away. It is there. You can almost see it if I move back and forth. But it's so minor that it doesn't even matter, so I'm pretty happy with this truck. As far as the work truck goes, this is awesome. I mean, this is a 2001, you know, Chevy whatever, and it has something like 300,000 kilometers on it. But the guy maintains it, looks after it. Tires are like new, brakes and everything. There's a video I did a while back with a 2002 Toyota Tacoma. And I basically had to rebuild the whole entire box, because you can't get a box for one of those, because, you know, that's what goes. And it was a pretty nice truck, half a decent cab, couple minor spots, good doors, but the box and front fenders were falling apart. And again, we made front fenders for that, actually. I did both sides. like basically redid the wheel arches. Where the box, I think I have something like 15, 16 patches in it. Big, substantial patches. But anyway, it can all be done. The customizing thing or bodywork, metal shaping. You don't have to be great at it. You just got to make things fit. And I mean, if you're patient, and the nice thing today, watch YouTube, a lot of videos on how to. And if a guy looks like he's doing something that's like way too advanced, well, that's okay. You'll probably get there. But go to the guys who just get the stuff done. Another one, if you want to build a piece that's really complicated, you can do it in multiple pieces, weld it all together. Check out, what is it, Fitzy's Fabrications. Just go check him out. The guy does really good work, and I watch all his videos. He's super entertaining. He's always playing with cool stuff. And the thing with him is he's, I think he's out in Newfoundland where, you know, they're on the island or whatever. So you can't get parts, you can't get stuff. So he has to make everything. Great videos, because it's funny. I used to always just buy parts, even though I know how to make stuff to some degree. But after watching his videos, if I need a part and I don't have it, I'm not waiting 3 days. I just make it now. And it's literally that simple. So we did the rockers. You can almost see where they come up to right here, and they're welded in. Something about, oh yeah, so nothing fit. I had to do inner rockers, and basically I made all those pieces. We replaced the floor on this side, made that. Oh yeah, that's what it was. The rockers we bought, but the cab corners were on back order, and I didn't want to wait. So I made those. Someone had already replaced them and they went up too high, so I just cut them out and they're starting to rust. And I just made my own pieces. And I mean, they look as good as anything the factory ever did. And the funny thing, after I made the two pieces, I went over to my shelf and I actually had one sitting in there with all the pile of scrap. So I guess I didn't have to make them both, but I mean, for the 20, 30 minutes it took, you know, and I mean, we didn't come way up crazy and do all this arch. All we needed was up to about here. So we made those. We made those. The doors I simply replaced. So the first thing I had to do is tape everything off and jam the doors. And then I shut the doors. We basically back taped off the edge of the cab just so that, you know, you have a nice clean transition. Yeah, you can't even tell, but basically what I did, now here I had to run the rubber, so I got a thing jammed in behind that just to move it out so the clear will go in. But anyway, from here down, you basically put tape past and then pulled it back and then shut the door just to lie against it. So there's this, I don't know if we're going to be able to see it, but there is a tiny little tape line, but I mean it's super minimal. And we had to do that because up here, something was rubbing up here. So you could see bare metal all there from whatever that was. So we fixed that. But these doors were off of a gray truck. So I basically had to paint all this and clear coat it all and so on. So there's probably a transition edge just on the inside of this somewhere. But I mean, you're not going to see that. The only place that kind of sucked, I usually like to run a foam J-tape down across the bottom, where here I didn't, so there's a little bit of a blur there. But, you know what? I don't really care. If you saw pictures of this truck, and I think you can go back and, I don't know if there's videos, I think there is. I was surprised he wanted to fix this truck. It was rough. The doors were bad. The rocker had basically fallen off this side. The one on the other side was all rusted up. Needed some work, not a complete replacement. But I think I made like a lower piece across the bottom, because just the inner edge where it goes to the inner was bad. The lowers of the front fenders were bad. And then, of course, we couldn't get the Chevy fenders. And the GMC fenders, I think what happens is they come up higher because the bumper's higher, and then it dips down and does funny things. So your fenders, your bumper, it's all different. And your grill's different, the cutout for the light. Like, it don't fit. So we fix these, and I mean, it's not that hard. If I can do it, I'm thinking anybody can do it. But yeah, this little truck turned out pretty nice. I think it's just a, oh no, actually it is a 5.3. He told me it was a 5.3. I thought it was a 4.8. So, I mean, this thing's healthy, runs great. Like, look at that. Looks just like factory. You'd never know that these were off of a gray truck from Saskatchewan. So that's really cool. Basically, the doors in the box are off another truck. So, but anyway, that's enough of this video. I probably babbled on too long. Just wanted to show that gun trick. You know, you guys out there that have never seen that done, try it. It's pretty cool. I mean, the back of the cab is pretty shiny. The reflection in it is almost like the window. I mean, look at that. Look at that. You can't argue with that. That's pretty good. And this was shot quick and dirty, and this is not a show truck by no means, but it's nice. All right, thanks. Later.